The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our next Ask the Expert session. Today, we're going to talk about SAP Access Control GRC and SAP Cloud IAG. Our two presenters today are Alessandro and Martin, our GRC experts here. And just a couple of housekeeping questions before we get started. Again, this is one of several Ask the Expert series or webinars. So we're going to have a couple of more coming up. There is a link here that you can see on the slide where you can not only see the upcoming sessions, but you can also submit your questions up front. The more questions we get up front, the better we can prepare and answer them during the webinar. Of course, if you have any questions throughout this webinar, you can use the questions panel in your go to webinar control panel. Just type in your questions. We keep an eye on them. And then at the end, we'll answer those questions as well. Webinar will be recorded and you will receive a link to the recording and probably also an email from Sean from our team to follow up. Make sure you got all of your questions answered, or if you have any additional ones that you can, you know, we can maybe help answer offline. And with that being said, I'm going to hand it over to Alessandro and Martin, and they're going to walk you through today's Ask the Expert session.
Perfect. Thank you, Michael. Welcome, everyone. My name is Alessandro Benzer. I'm in charge of the Americas business within Xiting. I'm a senior consultant when it comes to access control, GRC, SAP IAG, but then also security in general when it goes about authorizations management in S4 HANA, in SAP Fiori, and so on.
Martin. Hello, my name is Martin Traxel. I'm CEO Switzerland and senior security consultant, especially for SAP Access Control and SAP Cloud EAG, and further SAP Authorization Management, so the different topics in SAP security environments.
Perfect. Then let's get into the questions. We got a few questions. We consolidated them. We'll just, you know, try to go through them. We have a couple of slides prepared because a few questions were, you know, in kind of a more architectural. So we kind of want to show you guys and walk you through a few things. As Michael said, if there's anything that comes up during the session, just use the GoToWebinar controls panel, the questions box, type it in there, and we'll try to answer them throughout the webinar. One of the questions that was asked was regarding the embedded GRC versus the standalone. Most of you guys probably have a standalone access control installation where, you know, basically have one system and, you know, there you installed the access control foundation component. Now with GRC 12.0, there's also one of the versions that's called the embedded version for S4 HANA, specifically for S4 HANA. And the question was, what is the difference? From a functionality perspective, there's no difference. It's you have the same functionality in the embedded as you have in standalone. The only difference really is that instead of having a separate system that, you know, you run GRC, the GRC foundation on, you have it embedded on your S4 HANA environment. That basically, you know, saves you hardware costs because, you know, we all know you have a dedicated GRC landscape, you have dev, quality, production probably. That's, you know, associated with some cost. That's something you can bury into the S4 HANA if you go with the embedded approach. From a functionality perspective, as I said, there's no difference. You can run pretty much, or you can definitely run everything that you can run in standalone also in the embedded approach. I hope that makes sense. Then there were a lot of questions in regards to the IAG, which I think because it's a new product, it's cloud solution from SAP. There were a lot of questions in regards to IAG, and one of them was, you know, again back to probably very basics, but you know, if we're just starting out in that topic, was around what is the difference between the access control on-premise solution as we know it from the past and now the cloud IAG, the cloud identity access governance, a cloud product, a software as a service solution from SAP. At the end of the day, IAG does not directly replace access control. It's a solution. It's a completely newly developed solution on the business technology platform, on the cloud. It's a software as a service solution that at the end of the day provides similar capabilities that access control does on the on-premise side. So we have the access risk analysis, you know, can have a rule set. We can analyze our users, our roles for, you know, SOD conflicts, critical access, sensitive access, stuff like that. We have the access request management where we can run workflow-driven approaches. We have firefighting capabilities. We have review and recertification capabilities like user access review. And then obviously we also have the business role management, which is the business roles that we can create, that we can reuse in the access request management for provisioning. So at the end of the day, it's an entirely new solution that doesn't necessarily replace access control. It certainly can in certain aspects, depending on what you guys need, it can replace. But also for most of the customers, it's probably more an extension of the current access control. And that's we'll see that here in just a couple of minutes. I have a slide prepared for that, where we can basically connect IAG with access control through a so-called IAG bridge capability, where basically you can save your investments you have done on the access control side and then extend your access control installation through the IAG bridge with the IAG in the cloud to, at the end of the day, to have the same capabilities that you have for your on-premise world, also for cloud applications. So for example, if you have Ariba, SuccessFactors, Analytics Cloud, Marketing Cloud, whatever cloud products you have from SAP, and if you want to control that from a risk perspective, from an access provisioning perspective, through your access control installation, then you require the IAG bridge with the IAG in the background to do the provisioning, to do the risk analysis, and so on for the cloud products. So they also work hand in hand if you choose to do so. As I mentioned, IAG has very similar capabilities. Therefore, it could also be that IAG can replace the access control. But that there's a couple of caveats to it and limitations at the moment. So you really have to look into whether you can really replace access control with IAG as it stands today. From a rule set perspective, there was also a lot of questions regarding the rule set. Can I reuse the rule set? Yes, you can for the on-premise world. So let's say you have a rule set, custom rule set, or even if you use the standard rule and you have done some modifications to it, you can reuse that also if you move on to IAG for the on-premise systems. So if you have today in access control, you analyze your S4HANA, for example, and you want to analyze the S4HANA with IAG, then you can repurpose and reuse that rule set in IAG. There's also upload, download capabilities to get that rule set into IAG. When it comes to cloud solutions, like SuccessFactors, Ariba, Analytics Cloud, and so on, obviously you require new rules, and those you have to build specifically then for IAG. The approach and how you build them is very similar as it is in access control. The rule set is still the rule set from an architectural perspective. It is still very similar. Now, obviously with IAG, whether we use it standalone or then in the combination with access control through the IAG bridge, what you can obviously do from a rule set perspective is you can build cross-system SODs. So you can have an SOD between an on-premise system, like for example, your S4HANA, and then also cloud application like Ariba. And then, IAG would analyze, cross-system risks for your users, for example. Hope that makes sense. And we'll see the architecture here in just a second. Then again, a lot of questions regarding the IAG solution, and also, what can we do with cloud products like Ariba, Analytics Cloud, also SuccessFactors, and at the end of the day, that become very popular. A lot of customers are implementing those. As I mentioned, if you connect to cloud applications, then you require the IAG. So if you have access control and you want to connect to Ariba or Analytics Cloud or Marketing Cloud, you require IAG. The only cloud solution that you can directly talk to from access control is SuccessFactors. You can directly connect SuccessFactors to access control, and then access control can do the risk analysis. You can run your workflows through it for access provisioning, and you can also use the HR-driven identity lifecycle, the HR trigger from SuccessFactors into access control. That's possible. All the other cloud solution, like I mentioned, Ariba, Analytics Cloud, and so on, you require IAG. Access control does not have any connectivity or connectors to those applications. For that, you need the IAG bridge scenario. and then you can use that as well. There was also one question in regards to SAP Intelligent Asset Management, if you can integrate that. Today, not. That's planned for Q1 2022, so that should be next couple of months, that should be available. I also posted the link here to the roadmaps, so you can always see the status of the developments with IAG on roadmaps.sap.com. Now let's talk about a little bit about that integration, and mentioned it already. So at the end of the day, what do we see here? So on the bottom here, we have our on-premise world, where we have, for example, access control. You might even run identity management, but let's just specifically talk about access control. So basically you have your access control, and with that access control, your governing access and you run risk analysis against your on-premise applications, whether it's S4 HANA, NetViewer based system, or even SAP HANA database. You can run different processes for the on-premise world. Now, what's not directly possible, other than the success factors, like I said, success factors can be directly connected to access control. You don't need IAG for success factors, but for all the other applications, you require the IAG. And if you use that in combination, then what happens is, or why do we do that? First and foremost, it's mostly because on the access control side, you have invested a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of resources to build that access control. You have workflows, you have everything that runs through access control. You probably even use Fiori apps for the end users, so you have a very intuitive way to access or to govern the access. And you don't necessarily want to change that because it's proven. You might still be writing it off from a financial perspective, and you kind of want to preserve that. But at the same time, you have the requirement to now also deal with the cloud. And from that perspective, that's very often when we use the IAG bridge. Also, because access control, since it's an on-premise solution, is more flexible than the IAG. The IAG, at the end of the day, is a software as a service product. That means it's software as a service. You cannot change the code. Versus on the access control side, you can. We can modify the code in the worst case. Often we don't want to do that. That's not recommended, but we could if we want to. But the access control also offers a lot of implementation points or user exits that we can tie into. Just think about the business rule framework, the BRF plus MSMP workflows, where we can configure different things. There's now also intentions in the IAG side, especially when it comes to that BRF plus MSMP side, to also have that with business rules. There is the developments going in that direction. We already have some capabilities, but not to an extent as we have it in access control today. And so from that perspective, a lot of customers have very customized access control installations, and you kind of want to reuse that and repurpose that now also for cloud. And that can be, for very specific workflows where you have, not a standard approval process. Maybe you split where IAG or in standard, you cannot split, but just be on regions or whatever attributes you use to split workflows. That's something that's not possible in IAG today. And so therefore, the step to really connect the cloud is using the IAG bridge scenario and then connect the cloud. From a workflow perspective, how would it look like? Or from an end user perspective, it basically means you're repurposing the access control installation, you connect it with IAG, and then your end users, whether it's the employees who create the request, whether it's the approvers, all that runs on access control. And then at the end of the day, when it comes to provisioning, when it comes to the risk analysis piece, then you utilize IAG. So basically let's just talk about access provisioning, for example. If you run the workflow through access control, and here, your request roles for your on-premise applications, but also for your cloud applications like Ariba, SuccessFactors, and so on, they get approved. All that is in access control. And then once it's approved and the provisioning starts, then access control will provision the on-premise world and IAG will provision the cloud world. That's the integrated approach in that IAG bridge scenario, as we call it, for a holistic approach when it comes to provision hybrid landscapes. I hope that makes sense. And here you can kind of see basically at the end of the day what happens if you have a fully function fully functioning access control. You know, your users, your approvers, everyone is used to it. They're trained on it. And now you connect IAG and you connect systems like Ariba. From a employee approval perspective, nothing really changes. Because at the end of the day, in access control, Ariba, SuccessFactors, Marketing Cloud, all those are just another connector. So whether you have 5 on-premise systems and 2 up and 2 cloud systems, it doesn't matter. It looks exactly the same. It feels the same. It's the same process as the user used to. So that makes a lot of sense to repurposing the access control installation. I hope that makes sense. If you have any questions, like I mentioned, just type it into the questions panel, and then we'll also answer them as we go along here. One other question is always regarding the integration with HR or success factors. We know in access control, we have the HR triggers where we can basically, you know, handle the join, remove, or leave process from an HR perspective. So if an employee, you know, joins the company, user accounts are created. If they change the job, then we do, for example, a user access review. And if there's a termination, someone leaves the company, the user account needs to be terminated. And those processes very often we want to automate. And in access control, a lot of you guys have done that with the HR trigger. On the access control side, if you move to success factors, you can also do that. As I mentioned before, success factors can directly be connected to access control for risk analysis, for provisioning, but also for the HR trigger. The same for success factors is also possible in IAG. So in IAG, we can also connect to, obviously, it's a cloud product. We can obviously talk and connect to cloud solutions directly as well. So basically here, it's very similar from a process perspective as it is in access control, where we can use a source system, which is sub-X success factors. And then success factors will basically similar as in access control, so HR triggers, you know, send the events into IAG. And then in IAG, we can build rules. That's when the business rules come into play. And based on the rules and how we define those, we can automatically create access requests, whether it's for create user, update user, or whatever the case might be. And then at the end of the day, we're provisioning on-premise applications, or also then obviously all the cloud applications. And that's possible for job change, for assignment changes, for terminations, and so on. So a lot of stuff is already possible with that integration as well. Very similar as it was with access control before, now just fully in the cloud. If you use the IAG bridge scenario, then obviously the success factors, the HR trigger would run in access control. This example here, the graphic here, this is purely for IAG. If you're just going to use IAG, not access control, then it's possible. And as I mentioned, if you use access control, it was already possible without IAG, but also in the combination, it is obviously possible. Then there were a couple of questions in regards to review processes, because that's a big requirement from an auditing perspective. You know, user access review, SOD review, risk review. There are the access certification service as part of IAG is one of 5 services, which is called access certification, is available in IAG. As of today, the access certification process offers the user access review. So we can basically start campaigns, they now are called campaigns in IAG, and those campaigns allow us to review user access. And you know, it's a process similar to the UAR, as we know it from access control, where we can define the users to be reviewed based on different attributes. We can filter and select the users we want to review, and then we can run them through the review process. From a workflow perspective, there is some flexibility, you know, who are the reviewers, whether it's the manager, whether it's the role owner, or whether it's a combination of them, that's already possible. SOD review, risk review is not available today. That's on the roadmap. If I'm not mistaken, it's planned for Q3 this year. I would have to confirm, but right now, the only review that can be done that is fully functioning is the user access review. Then one other question in regards to firefighters. A lot of you guys probably use the firefighters in access control. Similar capabilities are also available in IAG, but it's limited to on-premise applications. So similar to access control. In IAG, the only firefighter setup that we can do is the ID-based firefighter, as we call it from access control. The role-based, not even sure if you guys are aware of that. In access control, there's two types of firefightings, and you can either use the one or the other. Cannot use both, it must be one or the other. Most of you guys obviously use the ID-based firefighters where you have dedicated user IDs that can be used. The role-based firefighting, where you could actually assign roles to a user, firefighting roles to a user, that's not available in IAG. So IAG only supports the ID-based firefighters, and at the moment only for on-premise applications. So for your S4HANA, for example, it is possible. Cloud applications like SuccessFactors, Ariba, and so on are not supported. I also haven't seen anything on the roadmap, and I think there's the issue there is the difficulties or the limitations with the authentication to cloud products because of single sign-on and all that stuff. It's not as easy to just change the user IDs in the cloud because it's all with single sign-on, obviously, and has to be secure. So you cannot just swap IDs. That's not as simple as it is on the on-premise side. So at the moment, cloud firefighters are not possible. Then generally, from an IAG perspective, and as I said initially, a lot of questions are about IAG, was in regards to licensing. Here, what I can tell you is there's two different license types available. There's a full version and there's an integration edition version. So it's the two types. The full version is basically licensed based on the unique monitored users that you sync into the IAG. So if you sync 10 backend systems, whether it's cloud or on-premise, doesn't matter, and you sync them into IAG, then it's basically the unique users. So if I exist on 10 systems, I'm counting as one user license. That's for the full version, and then the integration edition is based on unique type of connections. So if you have an ABAP connection, that's one type. If you connect to SuccessFactors, that's a second one. In both editions, you get the full capabilities. There's no limitations to capabilities. It's more from a licensing perspective, how you pay license fees. I posted the link here if you want to learn a little bit more. A couple of information is available online. But at the end of the day, when it comes to licenses, you have to talk to your account manager at SAP, and they will help you through the licensing models. Perfect. That was the question that were submitted up front. Tino, do we have anything else?
There is what the customer is going to ask us is if I don't have any GRC yet, I think to implement a GRC system from SAP, what should I choose? So I'm going to choose the cloud version because that is what SAP says in the future that cloud is the thing, or should I go to implement both, still both, so the GRC access control on-prem and premise and the SAP IAG in the cloud. So what we see is if the customer is really going to get a GRC new implemented, they are going to choose SAP IAG. Just as well about the roadmap from SAP, I think Alessandro, they are going to extend that as well in future with more functionalities and go a little bit more to identity access management system a little bit more. It's just clear. It's like for compliance governance, but with the access requests and the workflows behind, and we think that will be in the future going this direction.
Yes, and to add on to that is also regarding SAP IDM, right, Martin? SAP at the moment didn't commit to SAP IDM beyond, I think, 2027.
Yes.
So it kind of seems or looks like IDM will be phased out, and then the IAM solution, the Identity Access Management solution from SAP, is the IAG. Obviously not confirmed. That's just how we see it, because again, there's no commitment from SAP for SAP IDM. That therefore it looks a lot like, you know, IAG will kind of fill in that gap in the future. And I think there's also a lot of developments in that direction with the business rules now, with the business rules service, where we basically have the ability to customize workflows, you know, to route them differently, to use attributes to, you know, pick approvers and so on. It looks a lot like it's going that direction. Yeah, but from my perspective, you know, in regards to whether using access control or IAG, I mean, a lot of customers have a cloud first strategy. So the cloud obviously is the preferred solution, but there's pros and cons as always. Access control, like I said, I think the big pro for access control is it's an on-premise application, which you're responsible for it. You can manage and you can, you know, you have the flexibility over the solution. You can, you know, at the end of the day, do with it whatever you want to do within your limitations, obviously. In IAG, it's software as a service. So if SAP decides to change certain things, it's just going to change. And you know, if there's a new release, new upgrade, so to say, you will just be upgraded. On the access control side, because it's on-premise, it's always up to you to decide whether you want to have the next support package or not. That's a few things that we know, I think need to be considered. And then again, at the end of the day, I think one very valuable solution is the IAG bridge, having access control, having all the advantages of access control, and then extending into the cloud with IAG. I don't see any other questions. Michael, Martin, do you guys see anything? Maybe I'm missing something here.
I don't see any unanswered questions in our control panel.
Okay. If we have no other questions, then I would say we're good, right? Everything must be answered then.
Yeah, I think so.
On time.
Right on time. Perfect. Okay, great. Maybe do you want to show the slide again real quick with the upcoming sessions and the link, just to make sure?
Yep.
So those are the upcoming sessions. You know, there's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more. And then maybe the link real quick as well for people to submit questions. I also got a couple of emails during the webinar with where can I watch the previous sessions, and there's a YouTube playlist. You should have all received an email with a link to that playlist. If not, please drop us an email either to Alessandro or to mcoomer@xiting.com. Let us know and we'll send it out again. But it's all in a playlist. Every new session will be part of that playlist. So if you have the link once, bookmark it and you can use it over and over again. I typically upload every session recording on the same day that the session happened. So in the next couple of hours, you will see today's session in that playlist as well. And submit your questions for the next, for the upcoming Ask the Expert series. And we're looking forward to seeing you next week.
Perfect. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.